press the bell icon on the YouTube app to never miss a video from News Laundry.
Hello and welcome to News Laundry Interviews. I'm Amit Bhardwaj, and today we have with us Ullekh NP. He's the executive editor of Open Magazine. He has written three books, one in 2015, the other in 2017, which is titled Untold Vajpayee. And the reason he is here today is this book, Kannur, Inside India's Bloodiest Revenge Politics. Welcome, Ullekh.
Thank you very much, Amit.
So before we start the interview, last year I was also in Kannur, and I've read the entire book, and it was kind of a throwback moment, or I was going into that memory of traveling from one place to other, meeting the families. And I believe, and also you are from Kannur, you have more experience about the geography, the politics, and the people who live there. But the experience I think it's a shared experience that you have written in the book, and that I could feel while meeting all these families who have lost their near and dear ones. One question which always hits us who are not from Kerala, or who are from the northern part of the country, that, you know, why Kannur? Why there's a lot of violence in Kannur? What's the reason?
No, the thing is, it's not just the people from outside of Kerala who look at it in a strange way and, you know, find it so weird. Even people from other parts of Kerala, you know, they look at the place as something out there, you know. And I've explained it in detail, that when I was in boarding school, you know, people used to say it was, you are from the Bihar of Kerala and things like that. So it's not just, you know, there is a river which is almost bordering Kozhikode and Kannur. So once you cross that river, you know, like south, towards the south, and then you are looked down upon because you happen to be from Kannur. You know, looked down upon, not in, you're made fun of for the culture of violence that you have in Kannur. So even the people in other parts of Kerala find it strange, you know, why is that, you know, there is a cycle of violence that is unending. And, you know, like if you look at closely at Kerala politics, violence is not typical. It's not just confined to Kannur. You've had long years of violence, especially between the RSS and the CPM, in other districts like Palakkad and also Alappuzha. But things ended, you know, they could find a solution to the violence in other parts, but not in Kannur. So, which is what I'm trying to examine in this book, what is the reason? And, you know, and even if you look from a national perspective, you know, do we have any other case of extreme revenge politics in which people of same caste groups, or, you know, like religious groups, you know, from within the clan, they fight each other and die for no reason, you know. So, you know, I use this expression, death has lost its sting in Kannur. So, which is true. And, you know, I'm trying to find out, you know, what are the reasons why this continues to go on and on. So there are a lot of historical reasons that pundits tend to peddle, and, you know, there are a lot of historical reasons, mythological explanations, spiritual explanation that they come up with, because, you know, Kannur is a place that has had, you know, like even one of the most senior police officers who is alive in Kerala, Mr. Alexander Jacob, he was a DGP, and he had served in Kannur for a long time. According to him, it's, you know, it might sound as ahistorical and unacademic, and, you know, like purists and historians might find fault with him. But there are a lot of people who think there is a spiritual angle to it, and also this happens because there has been a effervescence of, or large, he uses the expression infusion of a huge mix of racial mix of martial races for over 2,000 years, and you know, from Assyrians to people from who had come from Central Asia, and you know, lots of other people.
Sri Lanka as well.
Yeah.
No, interestingly, Mr. Alexander Jacob's theory is, if you speak to the politicians, I'm sure you have spoken to the politicians as well, and you have actually spoken to the historians in the book. And he goes on to mention number of theories where he is also mentioning about the Thia community, or he is mentioning about the racial mix through which Kannur has gone, or the northern Malabar region rather has gone through. And also about the Kalari culture which was there, or the Chegawa culture for that matter. But the politicians, specifically from CPM and the RSS, both people go on to reject all these theories, and they are very strong while countering the theory that most of the people who are being attacked or who are victim of this violence also belong to Thia community. So what's the reason of this rejection, denial?
You know, I think it's one, it's ignorance. Second, it's, you know, just a matter of denial to say that, you know, there is nothing, you know, once you live in a place, like you live in Bombay for a long time and you get used to local trains, and then you treat hardship as business as usual. And similar is the case with those who live in Kannur and politicians who practice whatever, political practitioners who are long-time politicians tend to feel that this is something business as usual. You know, I want to, before I come into my assessment of why this violence is so rampant and unending in Kannur, and why there is a particular community that is pivotal to you know, perpetuating violence at the behest of the political masters, I want to bring in a certain kind of a perception that some of the spiritual leaders I've spoken to, all this might, you know, it all looks like something very magical realism sort of a thing. But there is a perception that, you know, like the samurais, the Chekavas used to fight with each other,
right,
to settle scores between the princelings or the kings, you know, the local chieftains, landlords, you know, who had some quarrels among them, you know, in between them. So they didn't settle on their own. They would call for a duel, and, you know, like people who are trained to fight using different weapons, you know, like including, you know, huge swords and stuff. They would fight each other until one person dies. So, you know, one person dying creates a lot of heartburn and a sense of loss in the in the family of the person who dies. So these spiritual leaders now tell me that, you know, these souls of the dead,
right,
which that have not found any kind of redemption, you know, are a curse to the land that is Kannur.
Also because they might be feeling that they died without a reason.
No, right, they died death, like a dog with no reason, you know, like Hemingway said of modern wars. So that is one reason. So, you know, you don't know. I don't know. I have just presented it as their opinion, their views, and I've left it there. But another major reason, you know, like that even historians and academics and, you know, serious analysts of the situation, you know, and violence that happens, even those people who have studied global conflicts and, you know, political violence far worse than this in other places, agree on the fact that it could be because of something that is particularly different in that region compared with others. If you look at the whole of Kerala, especially in compared with southern Kerala, which had seen, you know, which was buffeted before the Congress or the communist parties came into the fore by social movements, you know, led by people like Srinarayana Guru, Chattampi Samigal, Sahodana Yepen, and even from Dalit communities, they sort of changed the whole social structure. They challenged the hierarchy, Brahminical hierarchy of the time. And so they had a very fertile ground for the communist parties or any progressive parties to grow, including the Congress party of that time, which was not the case with North Kerala, especially this part that we are talking about, which is currently Kannur. You know, undivided Kannur had one more district as part of it, that was Kasaragod. So in that place, you know, what you've had is that social reformation movements that you had seen in other parts of Kerala did not happen much in these parts. And the first major political expression, you know, that happened in northern part of Kerala, especially where you, you know, this the place, the region in question, are militant trade union movements, militant peasant movements. First, it was the militant peasant movement. So these peasant movements and the trade union movements had its very militant character, which in South Kerala, they also had peasant and movements, but they were tempered by the presence of social reformation movements and a lot of...
Also the participation of communist leaders in the peasant movement and the crackdown by the Malabar police, special police. So that is part of the folklore, I believe, there.
Yeah, it's part of the folklore, and also that created that molded the political culture and individual behavior, both collective and individual behavior of political parties there. And what has happened is when the British was in power, they used brutal force against the British, against the Congress workers. And when afterwards, when India became independent, when the Congress came to power, you know, like you have to differentiate between the political movements in southern Kerala and north. You know, in southern Kerala, you know, I used the word that everything was, even the political movements were tempered by the presence of community groups, organizations that were the outcome of social reformations in South.
Right.
But in the North, it wasn't there. It was like a free-for-all for a long time where, you know, the political movements of the time were repressed. They were crushed under the feet first, when you take into account that of the Congress Party, by the British forces, and later after India became independent, communists became the victim of Congress tyranny. There is a difference between Congress tyranny when you talk about the leadership of the time, they were all Gandhians and all, but majority of the support of the Congress
were also the feudal landlords.
Feudal landlords who, with the help of the police, perpetrated these kind of activities. So the resistance on the part of the communists continued even after they regained dominance. They sort of became extremely dominant and far more powerful than their former perpetrators.
Actually, that triggers my second question. For the viewers' knowledge, so as you mentioned that it was the Congress which had to face a lot of crackdown from the British forces before independence, and post-independence it was the Congress along with the police, which, you know, Congress party used the state machinery to crush the
communists.
And there's a background that there were peasant movements, radical peasant movements happening on the ground, and which was also damaging the prospect of the feudal leaders from the Congress party. I'll go to page number 135 in the book. And also there's a common history that both RSS and the CPM, or the CPI rather, share, that both were banned.
1948.
And the ban for CPI was as long as 3 years, I believe. And in page number 135, there's a question by RSS leader Nandakumar. Why did a party with such a brute force in the state single out an organization like the RSS, which was at an infant stage? So he's asking this question in terms why the CPM chose to single out the RSS.
You know, the undivided party, the CPI, you know, CPM was formed in 1964. So he's referring specifically to an incident that happened in Trivandrum when Guruji Golwalkar went there for a function, and he was almost, we don't know, where there is the, reportedly he was assaulted, or there was an attempt to assault him, and the volunteers of the RSS hit back, and, you know, salvage the situation. That is what he is talking about. So there are several reasons to this kind of an attack. It's not especially because the communists were hostile to the RSS at that time. It could also be that across the country there was a, you know, almost all these communists came from the Congress stable, you know. Their nursery was the Congress, you know. When you look at all the leaders from A.K. Gopalan to M.S. Ambariparthi, they were not only Congress men, Congress workers, they were also Congress leaders. Many of them were presidents of the state Pradesh Congress committee at that time, and active members of the Congress Socialist Party.
Yeah, CSP.
Yeah. And ironically, one of those top Congress leaders who wrote the history, a book on the history of the Kerala Congress, who later became a communist, was, he was killed. He was beaten to death, Moyarath Shankaran. He's from Kannur. He was beaten to death by Congress goons, you know. That is all history. But, you know, this specific reference to Guruji being treated as an outsider, and, you know, that he was heckled at and perhaps, you know, tried to be assaulted. All these things, you know, if you look at it, it has more to do with the kind of polarization that he was trying to affect, you know, in terms of, you know, India at that time, you know, Mahatma Gandhi's ideals were considered supreme, and, you know, and he, RSS was known, and, you know, like Hindu Mahasabha before it, to have spewed venom at Mahatma Gandhi's ideals, and then looked down upon him, and, you know, like trying to trash him as an anti-national, you know, which currently has acquired different meanings. So it was based on this anti-Gandhi posturing. Maybe the reason that why that, you know.
What if I make this statement, not specific, but a generic statement, that RSS has been using not only in Kerala, but in the northern parts of the country and wherever they go for the elections. And I remember when there was this incident in Ramjas College where students were heckled and AVVP was accused of harassing these students. After that, the entire campus was full with hoardings showing how the CPM terror has struck the RSS workers, the volunteers there. So why, again, I would repeat that statement that CPM being one of the strongest organization, whether it is in power or it is out of power, it has very strong organization on ground in Kerala. Why would it single out organization like RSS, which is still a small organization compared to CPM, would go on to single it out and attack it constantly, as claimed by the RSS and the BJP leadership?
You know, I'm not trying to exonerate the CPM of its violent ways. CPM is a violent entity. The undivided Communist Party of India wasn't as violent as the CPM. And CPM's violent nature has got to do with the leadership which is in power at the moment, and, you know, which has had some kind of a vice-like grip over the party for decades now. So that is one. But to say that the RSS is a peacenik, and, you know, RSS is a party of Gandhian followers, is to miss the point. On the other hand, RSS in Kerala is an extremely well-networked, highly organized one. And its presence, its organizational strength is very disproportionate to the political fortunes of his political arm, the BJP. That, you know, like, just because it's not politically fortunate, just because its electoral prowess isn't as big as that of the CPM or even the Congress or the Muslim League, doesn't mean the RSS doesn't have any. RSS is a feeble entity. It's not. It's one of the Kerala unit of the RSS is one of the strongest. And if you look at the shakas, you know, the activities in shakas and all. RSS is a well-oiled machinery in Kerala, and you know, otherwise they wouldn't have been able to, even if they are calling it as a resistant, they wouldn't have been able to do it. And also,
right. In fact, this is very evident in numbers as well. If you go by the numbers, you know, the story that we did, the statistics clearly say that. In Kannur itself, RSS and CPM both have lost equal number of, almost equal number of workers. And if there's a, if CPM has a bigger organization, RSS has a smaller organization, it should be a bigger concern that despite being a smaller organization, the casualties on both sides is almost equal. Moving forward, you know, it's also about spreading the stories, who is able to, in the age of social media, and you know, propaganda being spread through the digital means. Three stories of RSS workers, I believe, is known across the country, and I am sure that it's also known in Kerala. The first person to die, Vadikal Ramakrishnan, the Jay Krishnan master murder case, and the third one who survived to share the entire horror of that.
Sadanand Master.
So, do you also think that it's the failure of the CPM to counter these narratives that has actually portrayed CPM in negative light across the country?
CPM doesn't have a national presence. It has presence in Kerala, and now it is confined mostly to Kerala. So, as a, for a national play, and you know, as far as some kind of strength in terms of campaign infrastructure or apparatus to spread that word that, you know, things are very different from what they are hearing. In one of the interviews, Mr. Pinarayi Vijayan himself conceded that, you know, outside of Kerala, at the national level, whatever the RSS says becomes, begins to be seen as the truth, because they don't have enough strength to spread the word or, you know, campaign against this national campaign. And coming to talk of retrocity campaign, you know, which was at the forefront of this campaign to malign, the malign or maybe point out, you know, bring to national attention atrocities that are happening, violence that's happening in Kannur. There are, you know, there are some very disturbing angles to it. You know, one, I was in the Northeast where people started talking about Kannur being a place where you witness genocide of Hindus. You know, a genocide of Hindus means what? It's Hindus are being killed by other religious communities.
Right.
You know, that's the intent. So what happens, you know, Kannur is a place where it has no history, it has no recent history of communal rights. Even if there was some kind of communal riot, nobody died in that communal riot that happened in 1971.
The Talisseri riots.
So this is the perception game, this is the kind of misinformation campaign that was unleashed by retrocity or those associated with the retrocity. I'm sure those at the helm of the retrocity campaign wouldn't have gone for such a lie, you know, to be at the top of their campaign, you know, strategy. But you know, it's possible that, you know, like they must have encouraged a murmuring campaign to suggest that this is genocide. And I know some people who actually was part of the retrocity campaign and were active on the social media to suggest that this is a genocide of Hindus. So but I don't want to name people. And this is, you know, they organized processions in 23 states, you know, drawing attention to put this on the fore, you know, to highlight so-called atrocities against Hindus.
In fact, I'll interrupt you in between. I met a number of police personnel, and the first question that they would ask me is, why you are here? Like, the political murders are happening. If you go by statistics, Uttar Pradesh is at the top of the list. So why, in terms of National Crime Bureau records? So what brings you to Kannur? So that question also remains, you know, a lot of journalists from the northern part of the country traveled to Kerala just to explore what was happening on ground. While you could see several union ministers going down to Thiruvananthapuram or Kerala and then taking out march protests. Amit Shah himself took out that march in Kerala. So CPM in a way has failed to spread that message outside Kerala, or it never bothered, you know, or worried about spreading, or felt the need of spreading that message outside Kerala.
Yeah, I mean, it was a failure on the part of CPM. That is the primary thing. Secondary thing is, perhaps, you know, they were convinced that, you know, such a national campaign, they didn't have the capacity for it. That's true. The other point is that, you know, this kind of misinformation campaign about RSS people, or, you know, mostly Hindus being bumped off as part of a major genocide campaign. These, you know, there was a pattern to that, you know, like there are people who suddenly landed up, there were people who suddenly landed in, ended up in, you know, Kannur and, you know, spent one day or so and came back. To suggest that, you know, like RSS people are murdered in hordes, you know, in party villages of, you know, controlled by the CPM and all. So, you know, it's like someone going to JFK coming back with an American accent. So, you know, this is one reason I wanted, you know, like if the CPM is a perpetrator of the crime, or if RSS is a victim, that story has to be told. But the story is not that. That is not the truth. So this is a violence between two political parties, and this is a violence that has a lot of dimensions, and this isn't a violence against Hindus by any other religious
group. And that's also funny. I mean, as you have mentioned in the book, that, you know, CPM is essentially a Hindu party, as in the cadre base is Hindu. And if CPM people are being killed, they are also Hindus and on the other side. So I don't know how that analogy works for the others. Moving forward, you know, you have mentioned on length about the families who have lost their near and dear ones. And you have given the detailed account. I would request the viewers, if they want to know what's happening there in Kannur, you can refer to this book, you can read this book. And coincidentally, I've also met a number of families that you have mentioned. And three families, you know, the memory has, it's very, I would say, it's very evident, and it refuses to go away as far as I am concerned. One was the family of Mohanan. The people in the village, the friends, they told me that they requested me rather that you should not meet his wife, because she'll fall ill if you meet her, and then she'll again go back in that, she'll be depressed again. The other family was of Dhanraj, the DFI leader, DYFI leader, and his son, I believe, is 11 year old, and he was giving a detailed account of how his father was murdered. And the third was Ramit's family, in Pinarayi Vijayan, from Pinarayi Vijayan's village, and Narayani is the name of the mother, and she has lost her husband in a similar kind of violence, and then the son was killed. So, do you also agree that, you know, a family's loss can end up being a gain for the party in Kannur?
You know, the thing is, for political parties, you know, like, it might sound like an apolitical statement, but it's not true in Kannur. You know, someone who is martyred, you know, he is feted as a hero, and his loss for the party is lapped up as a huge sacrifice. And therefore, I think there is an effort on the part of political leaders to take advantage of martyrdom of their own people, you know, party workers on both sides, all political parties, it happens.
And like erecting memorials in case of the
These things should happen, you know, in a highly politicized and, you know, highly violent climate of a place like Kannur. It's natural that such ritualistic measures are taken to take advantage or to keep reminding people that, you know, we have a martyr, our guys died, and, you know, more number of people have died and things like that. And on the other side also, people say the gruesome nature of the murder. You know, it's not that the CPM members were not killed in a gruesome fashion, but outside, you know, in nationally we have seen more of stories to do with the gruesome murders of the RSS. It's not always like that, but anyway, death of any member of the family, you know, the biggest loss is for the family, you know. And these are most of these people who die are earning members of the family. And so, you know, it disrupts the economic equilibrium of the family, which will never be, which can never be rectified later, possibly. And then these are able-bodied men in the ripe ages who die. So the kind of burden on even society, you know, in the local society is huge.
Two quick questions. You know, you have mentioned about three leaders, Kodiyari Balakrishnan, P. Jayarajan, and Chief Minister Pinarayi Vijayan. All three of them are considered to be one of the most important political figures in CPM today in Kerala. And they also belong from Kannur. So is it the phase of Kannur politics in Kerala right now?
Yeah, it's, I don't know whether it's a phase of Kannur politics in Kerala. You know, there were several chief ministers before, at least two, before Pinarayi Vijayan, who were from Kannur. And at that time, people, you know, E.K. Nayanar is from Kannur. Right. And the Congress veteran K. Karunakaran was from Kannur originally. So but these leaders are different from those other leaders in the sense that
they also have a history of violence or allegations
of violence against them. And also these are people who, who were molded in that crucible of extreme political violence and the culture of violence that was the hallmark of the 70s and late 60s and 70s and 80s and even the 90s. So the fact that they are at the helm of affairs in Kerala politics would not necessarily mean that the nature of the way the political behavior of Kannur would spread across to the rest of Kerala. But certainly it would vitiate matters within this district further.
Right.
You know, if some reparative actions are not taken.
You have also spoken, I've given the details about Pinarayi Vijayan, how he speaks, how he smiles, and the multiple interviews that you have taken. And you have mentioned, or maybe you made an effort to mention, that his temperament has changed. Now he's more willing to listen to the other leaders. So do you think that, you know, that process of bringing peace in the state, can, if it can happen, it will happen only under the leadership of Pinarayi Vijayan?
Because he is, you know, like each state or each political party would have a stronger leader than, if you look at Pinarayi Vijayan, you know, like the number of years he was at the helm of the party that were facing all kinds of odds. He's a great survivor, and that the fact that he's a great survivor has made him extremely powerful within the confines of within that Stalinist confines of his party. And naturally, he has, if he tries to do that, you know, things are going to be far more successful than any weaker, party leader would do. Naturally, and I think he's taking some steps, and then he has changed a lot from his earlier the kind of posturing that was very typical of him, you know, like all kinds of, you know, warmongering kind of, all kinds of sloganeering and, you know, heated exchanges and, you know, use of certain words that are considered unparliamentary. So this, all this has changed. So he, naturally, you know, and he has taken the initiative of bringing rival parties to the table, and right. you know, which it includes he himself. So he hopes that when I interviewed him, he hopes that things will be better if the RSS decides to cooperate and, you know, end this cycle of violence. Right. And which is what the RSS also, which is the same thing that the RSS also says.
Two quick questions. One, and before that, was it easier for you to get Pinarayi Vijayan to speak because of, you know, the fact that you belong from a Marxist family?
Yeah, it was, you know, I know him from my childhood, right. So naturally it was very easy to...
Easy. So, you know...
And it was easy to access, you know, get access to even RSS leaders. I have a lot of relatives in RSS also in Kannur, and, you know, nothing was difficult.
Okay, because it was part of your life, as we mentioned in the beginning. And one thing which, you know, I missed out to find on ground and which is there in the book is about the quotation gangs. Mm. Or the killer squads, as the media loves to quote it as. Yeah. So that is an interesting part to read in the book.
Yeah, you know, earlier, you know, what used to happen was any party like the RSS or the CPM, RSS used to get its cadres from outside of the state or maybe from other districts to commit these kind of crimes. And while the CPM had their own trained set of people who would, you know, like... very loyal people who would commit these kind of acts of crime. Hmm. Now, you know, things have changed. You know, it's a liberalized society. There is social media. There is also, you know, a sense of entrepreneurship that has set in. So naturally, maybe it's also an entrepreneurial effort for people who are used to killing for a party to look for avenues to make some money. So what they do is...
creating a Malda-like model, right, that works in West Bengal.
Yeah, I mean, it's true. So what they do is they, apart from doing this kind of work for the parties in question, they also look for freelance work, moonlighting or whatever you call it, and then it ends up being, you know, this is what you call the rise of quotation gangs. You know, that's the word that they use there, that you are paid and you kill, you know, right. to make money.
Right. One last question. I've read the book and there's a lot of detail in the last chapter. You were talking about the solutions, possible solutions. Alexander Jacob had mentioned a couple of them. You have mentioned a couple of them. But honestly, when I was on ground in Kerala speaking to a couple of leaders from both sides and specifically the only legislator from BJP, one thing which is evident is that both sides have pathological hatred against each other. In situations like this, when both the sides are adamantly saying that, you know, they are the one who need to stop the violence or they are the one responsible for violence, I don't see a hope that there could be, you know, successful peace talk or peace can be brought in Kannur. You being a son of the land, I would say, do you think that these politicians would be able to, as mentioned in the last chapter as well, would be able to bring peace?
It's a tragedy of errors of a long time. So it's not easy to correct and, you know, put everything on the track of peace, you know, very easily. But, you know, an effort, reconciliation has to begin somewhere. And like the one initiated, you know, mediated by Sri M, the spiritual guru between the CPM and the RSS, bringing the chief minister and the BJP president, all these people together to the table. These are initiatives that can have, you know, that are meaningful. And but, you know, these are just like very incremental efforts, and one has to see, you know, like, it's not that, you know, hostilities, you know, that extreme hostilities don't come to an end. They do. We have history of, you know, like history of history or history of conflicts, you know, that have proved that, you know, such hostilities do come to an end. But which is why the study of what are the roots and how does it happen, you know, what the human cost of this kind of a violence, and what is the price that even politicians and the nature of, you know, the way the politics is run, you know, the cost of the hidden costs of this violence, you know, what many people don't want to look at, you know, all these things I've tried to explain in the book for the simple reason that it might, you know, like inspire at least one or two people in the political firmament to look up and, you know, look for solutions, you know. I'm sure, you know, like, you know, this kind of a political culture will not have life in the coming years because, you know, people are more interested in their well-being and, you know, they want to live well and, you know, no one is blind enough to follow any one party and go after it, you know, nobody believes in, you know, because things were very different when the Soviet Union was still there and, you know, now, of course, the idea of Hindu Rashtra might still continue to inspire a lot of others to take up arms. But, you know, efforts on the part of the leadership should continue with a positive mindset. And the least thing that, the thing that we shouldn't encourage is pessimism.
Okay. And I would say that in the entire book, chapter 7 was my favorite because it gives a lot of details. And thanks a lot for speaking to us.
Thank you very much.